I'm a pretty big Doctor Who fan, but I definitely haven't seen all the Doctors, and I also definitely have fallen behind on the show.
And I have watched 3 total Doctors, but with the show being so expansive, it's now on the 16th Doctor. We decided that we would watch every single Doctor, or at least one story from every single Doctor, and see how they stack up. So we are starting at the very beginning, the classic Doctor Who, the first Doctor. And honestly, I really don't know a lot about Doctor Who outside of the few Doctors that I've watched. Before watching these shows, you and I were talking about it because you've seen some random episodes here and there. And all I know is that one of them Doctors has a really cool scarf.
At the time, that is all you knew.
It was. I knew that. And he was the one that I was most intrigued by. And, well, we'll see how he stacks up too. We asked our viewers, and most of you said to start with Christopher Eccleston, which was the start of the reboot of the show in 2005. That's a really good place to start. It's where I started when Jeremy got me into the show. But now that I have that Doctor Who taste, I want to know what all of the Doctors are like, even the earlier ones.
We decided instead of watching the first episode of every Doctor that we would use the Screen Rant article about the Doctor's best stories so we could experience the most iconic stories from each Doctor. The show launched in 1964 with William Hartnell playing the first Doctor. We tried to start with the first episode of the show just so we would kind of know what was going on, but we couldn't find that online. So we were kind of confused when we started the 4-part story, The Aztecs.
It turns out that the Doctor and Companion format that we are now used to isn't really how the show started. The premise of the first season is that these 2 teachers decide that they're going to follow their student Susan home, and it turns out that Susan is the granddaughter of the Doctor. These 4 characters, Barbara and Ian, who are the school teachers, the Doctor, and his granddaughter Susan, are who the show follows in the beginning. In the story that we watched, they travel back to Aztec times, and the Aztecs think that Barbara is a god, because the TARDIS ends up in a tomb that they come out of. The overarching plot of these episodes is that Barbara is trying to convince the Aztecs that they do not need to sacrifice people, and she, and I guess all of the characters, are trying to convince the Aztecs, especially to Toxel, who is a real creep, by the way, that Barbara is a god. Ian is trying to fight a warrior over some warrior title, I guess because there can only be one. And the Doctor spends the entire time trying to get back into the tomb. Ultimately, the Aztecs do still sacrifice people, but the core 4 make it back to the TARDIS and they avoid their own peril. Well, what did you think? Our first experience of the very first Doctor and his 3 companions?
It was definitely different feeling from what came later.
I agree. One of the things that you pointed out when we were watching it, I mean, obviously I could tell too, but it's in black and white. It's very different format.
But the TARDIS still felt pretty TARDIS-y.
Yeah.
Definitely had the same sound effects. Didn't look quite as nice on the inside, but still had a similar feel.
I thought it was really cool how the theme was still the theme. It's been the theme the whole time.
Yeah.
But the early version is so cool sounding.
Yeah. It's almost kind of spooky.
Yeah. I loved it. That was probably the highlight for me, was the theme. The thing that I found interesting about this story itself that we watched is that the Doctor wasn't really as much of a main character. I mean, there are 4 kind of main characters, but Barbara and Ian, the school teachers, seem to have so much more of a presence.
Yeah, I felt like they were more the main characters and he was kind of a supporting character.
Yeah.
He still had some Doctor quirks to him, but yeah, he felt like almost the and featuring, you know, person.
I did get a chuckle though. Because T'Toxel, one of the Aztecs, he was super creepy in every episode. He was just kind of weirdo. He was meddling. It was like, go away. And there is one point when the Doctor actually says,
"Oh, go away, T'Toxel."
And that was probably, I think, the single best line that the Doctor had from the arc that we watched.
Yeah, he had a couple of lines, but that was definitely one of the better ones. Mm-hmm. I also feel like it felt very stage acting-ish and not as much like a TV show or a movie.
That's fair. Yeah, that's, I didn't really think about that. It did kind of almost feel like a, like an old movie from the, I don't know, the golden era or something. Yeah, like a
40s or something like that. Yeah. We jump ahead to the fifth series or season, which is the second season of The Second Doctor, portrayed by Patrick Troughton. This four-part series is called The Tomb of the Cybermen. And just from the opening, it already seems much more sci-fi. We are on another planet, and a group of people on an expedition have uncovered a Cyberman tomb. The Second Doctor has two companions, Jamie and Victoria. As they approach the group of expeditioners, they are mistaken for another group of expeditioners trying to get into the Cybermen tomb.
I loved that these episodes were so much more suspenseful.
Fair,
I
mean, yeah.
Here are these people poking around, poking their heads where they shouldn't belong, and I'm familiar with Cybermen. I know, you do not want to get involved with that. And some of them, I guess, did want to. I just thought it was a really suspenseful show. It was like, every moment of it was like, ooh, don't do that, don't go there, yeah. Don't push that button.
I think that is a funny thing, like hitting a villain that you know from watching some of the other ones that was just kind of like, oh, I know what can happen now. This isn't going to be good.
And to add to that, I felt that when the Cybermen first came out of their tomb and it's kind of all slow and weird, it was so much creepier than present day Cybermen. I mean, those are some creepy, creepy Cybermen.
That's fair.
I mean, just don't look too close because they have like wiffle balls on their outfits, some kitchen appliances built in there.
Aren't as strong, but yeah, they are kind of creepy, like a slow zombie or something.
I think what's really cool though about their look is that, you know, when we've talked about television, you know, British TV shows and things, a lot of their viewers have pointed out that, you know, the BBC and networks in the UK have such a lower budget.
Yeah.
And that there's just so much less money to work with, that it is interesting to see kind of some of these very homemade looking costumes. And yet, even though they have this somewhat homemade look, they're still so eerie and creepy to me.
Yeah, definitely some of them are pretty unsettling.
I guess that also is a really interesting point about the first Doctor is that there were, when we were looking through the episodes, there were some that they had lost because they don't have the footage anymore.
Yeah, I think maybe definitely through the second Doctor, maybe even up to the third, there are chunks of episodes that are missing that they've redone through animation so you can actually still watch the stories.
I think that that is a testament to how well done Doctor Who is, that it can be this kind of show that started with a smaller budget, that they, you know, lost footage, or I guess I think I read that they had re-recorded over it and things like that.
Yeah.
And that's part of why it was lost. And it just speaks to how much it resonated with people that it's had the sustainability that it has.
I also feel like starting more with this second Doctor that he feels more like a main character and not maybe somewhat like a third build person on his own show.
Fair, yeah, I agree. He has two companions, which I thought was kind of an interesting thing that there are three of them instead of four, but yes, he was much more main character energy, as the kids are saying these days. And his companions were really fun too. I really like when shows kind of like push like gender norms and gender roles and things. There are a couple moments that where you see that Victoria is a little bit more brave, a little bit more daring, and that Jamie is the one that's a little bit more reluctant, the one that volunteers to not get into trouble and stay behind.
Yeah, that's true.
The Doctor warned me about you.
That was very clever of him.
Out of my way.
Why?
I'm going to open the hatch.
One of the things that I noticed about Patrick Troughton's portrayal of this Doctor is that he almost had a Willy Wonka vibe to me. I felt like he was a little bit like Gene Wilder Willy Wonka, where there was all this stuff happening. People were trying to make bad decisions all over the place. And he's like, I wouldn't do that if I were you.
Well, now I know you're mad. I just wanted to make sure.
And then he, unlike Willy Wonka, you know, was still there to clean up the messes that they made.
True, yeah.
So far, He's a very funny, very charismatic compared to the first Doctor.
Yeah, I agree.
Our introduction to John Pertwee, the third Doctor, is in a four-part series called Spearhead from Space. This is the first episode of the seventh season and the first introduction of the third Doctor. So I thought it was neat that we got to see a Doctor's introduction to a show. In this episode, the Doctor is working with UNIT, which is a military organization that investigates paranormal and extraterrestrial threats to Earth.
Oh look, a terrifying plastic baby head factory. That won't prove foreboding later.
We get introduced to a factory that's making a bunch of plastic people parts and learn over the course of the episodes that they are in fact manufacturing plastic people. We learn that these killer plastic fake people are acting as human duplicates, and essentially, their goal is to colonize the planet. The build of this episode is so slow. I feel like it was three episodes in and I still didn't know what the heck was going on. But it was cool to see kind of the beginning of a Doctor, the early on experience of people that he knows partaking in his regeneration and not recognizing yeah. him.
What do you think of my new face, by the way? I wasn't too sure about it myself to begin with. It sort of grows on you. Pretty flexible, you know?
Had a very different look to it. It was not only the first Doctor that was in color, at least that we saw, it was the first episodes that were shot on film. They looked different and really nice, actually.
Yeah, I agree. When we asked you about your favorite Doctors, a lot of you told us that either the third Doctor or the fourth Doctor was your favorite, just because of childhood nostalgia. That was your introduction to Doctor Who when you were younger. And I can very much see why the third Doctor is a good introduction. It's kind of progressing a little bit further forward into the direction that Doctor Who is more like now.
Yeah.
Or at least of the ones that I've seen of the reboot. And on the downside, seeing his very first episodes, we maybe didn't get to see like a real seasoned, real experienced
That's true.
Doctor, yeah. but I do think that this was a fun arc to watch.
Yeah, it was really interesting to see how they were intentionally hiding his face at first, because I'm assuming when he regenerated, you didn't see.
Potentially, yeah. And so it was kind of funny that he's in the hospital and he's like, doo doo doo, like, oh, the nurse is leaning over him and stuff.
This serial starts in Paris with the Doctor and his companion bickering over the view. And then they banter about the Mona Lisa, which is a very nice painting. We learn that an alien called Scarith is sent to steal the Mona Lisa to finance experiments in time travel, basically trying to revert the killing of his race 400 million years ago.
The fourth Doctor, as it turns out, is the one with the cool scarf.
He is the one
and
with the cool scarf.
And boy, is it a cool scarf. Tom Baker started his run in 1974, and these episodes are from 1979, so a couple years before the end of his run. So we're getting a little bit further into this character of Doctor, this version of Doctor. You know what I mean.
This version of the Doctor.
Yeah, you know what I mean.
He's seasoned. He's had a few years to be playing the character.
Watching this episode, there's a lot going on. There's a guy stealing art. He's like replicating art.
Yeah.
There's a detective that's on the case. There's a lot of time travel. But the episode itself and the things that are happening are less memorable than Tom Baker himself. And I can understand why he is such a fan favorite.
Yeah.
Because he is so charismatic and so funny. And just, I don't know, I feel like he commands the room when he's in it.
Captain Tancredi.
You know him?
No.
He'd want to question you.
Well, I'll want to question him so we can both have a little chat, can't we?
I think he really does. I mean, this is the Doctor that I had seen a little bit as a, like, child, teenager, because it was on a local station when I was a kid. And I didn't really ever get super into it, but I remember him. And now I know why I remember him as an adult, seeing it again and just going, oh yeah, he's really funny. Like you said, he's very charismatic.
Yeah.
He just has a great portrayal as the Doctor.
Yeah.
Even in just the few episodes we've seen.
Yeah. There were a lot of laugh out loud moments. There's a moment where he goes into the villain's mansion
yeah.
and the butler kind of like throws him into the room and he says,
I say, what a wonderful butler. He's so violent. Hello.
And I just laughed so hard at that. It was so funny. I love that humor can hold up so well. He is probably my favorite so far. This is the first time that we got to see a sonic screwdriver.
Yeah, even though apparently back to the second Doctor had it, so the second and the third Doctor had it.
We just saw it in this episode, yeah. Or this Doctor. So that was kind of fun. And also, this one had a new intro, and it had a very late 70s, early 80s feel. I didn't like it quite as well as the earlier intro, but it's kind of fun to see the different
intros as they change.
As they change, exactly.
It's going to get real 80s later.
If you are new here, or if you've been around in a while and you haven't subscribed yet, make sure you subscribe. It really does help us out. Hit that little subscribe button down there. Thanks. For the fifth Doctor, played by Peter Davison, we watched the four-part series, The Caves of Androzani. The plot of these episodes? Well, it's basically Dune. The people on the planet of Androzani Minor, a desert planet, are fighting over a drug called Spectrox. And the Doctor and his latest companion end up in the middle of it. But you know what Dune doesn't have? British Chuck Norris. This story was much darker than the previous episodes that we've watched, and the Doctor just didn't quite seem as funny. There's a character called, I think his name was Sheriz Jek. He was really creepy, and he had this army of androids. He was basically trying to mess up the Spectrox mining. I mean, it was basically the plot of Dune, and he was the rebel trying to mess things up. The Doctor and his companion Perry, they end up stepping in raw Spectrox, which turns out to be toxic. But there is an antidote, and it is bat milk of some kind. And he ends up going and getting enough bat milk for them to both have, but he drops one of the containers of it in getting out of there. And there's only enough to save Perry. This is the end of his run as the Doctor. He ends up regenerating because of this.
This is pretty painfully 80s.
I didn't realize before watching this that this was the end of Peter Davison as the Doctor. This is the first regeneration we've seen. So I thought that was kind of interesting. I think as a whole, this episode felt so similar to Dune that, I don't know, it didn't quite resonate with me. I felt like the Doctor was not quite as strong. The amazing thing about Doctor Who is that with the whole regeneration thing is that it gives each person who plays the Doctor a chance to really embrace the character and make it their own and give it, you know, quirks and things. When you're following someone as good as Tom Baker, I think it was just a little bit underwhelming. And I would like to see more of the season or more of his performance, but I was a little bit underwhelmed by this story as a whole.
Yeah, I don't know, it just didn't have quite the same feeling to it.
Mm-hmm.
And I would eventually like to go back and watch some more of his stories, but it would be lower on my priority list than some of the other Doctors.
I think maybe there could be other episodes that would be a little bit more lighthearted or a little bit more whimsical, because I did find his outfit to be quite whimsical.
With the celery on his vest.
His striped pants and his celery. Sure. I was like, this is actually a little more whimsical and almost corny compared to the scarf. Like, the scarf was the first kind of weird extreme that was quirky and fun, and I felt like this was pushing it into like a kind of corny territory.
But get ready.
But yeah, get ready. It just gets worse from here. The sixth Doctor is only two episodes.
But they're longer episodes, so it's kind of basically
the same. But it's only two episodes, so that's kind of fun.
Revelation of the Daleks is the last serial in the next season, where the sixth Doctor is portrayed by Colin Baker. It is set on Necros, and Darvos, one of the big bads that is portrayed throughout the series, is posing as the Great Healer. The planet is facing famine, and he's using a funeral home called Tranquil Repose as a base to convert humans into food, or into Daleks for his secret army. Davros's manufacturing partner wants his business and hires a pair of assassins to kill him.
Colin Baker, I think, is a really fun Doctor. I really enjoyed his performance. However, I cannot get over his outfit. It is so beyond corny and ridiculous.
One, you throw on top of that his normal, pretty ridiculous outfit that in the beginning of the episode, he's walking out in the snow wearing a blue, like, cape on top of his ridiculous outfit.
I did really enjoy his performance.
Yeah, I think he was good.
I thought the episode itself was a good episode.
Yeah.
Or two episodes.
Daleks, which is always a nice hallmark of Doctor Who. I do think the weird radio DJ for the dead people was weird.
Oh, I forgot about that. Yeah.
Or in stasis people, whatever.
It felt like one of those like high school radio DJ kind of
bizarre.
Yeah, it was. That was bizarre.
It wasn't bad even, but it was just weird.
I also thought that Perry, this companion, was very whiny. She was less relatable than pretty much any other companion that we saw, I think.
I guess that's fair. I didn't have a big problem with her, but I guess I can see that.
Colin Baker, I thought, was a very funny doctor, though.
Yeah.
And there were a lot of really funny one-liners that he had. And there's this scene where one of the characters shoots Davros's hand off. And there are a few funny moments that come from that. Like the doctor saying,
"No harm in trying."
I'm always down for a good pun and some good silly humor. So I thought this was very enjoyable overall.
I liked it overall.
There were a lot of characters in this episode and a lot of different character storylines. And so I don't think we got to really experience his performance quite as much as some of the other doctors.
Yeah, that's probably fair.
But from what I did see, I really enjoyed
him though.
In The Curse of Fenric, the seventh doctor, played by Sylvester McCoy, is joined by his companion Ace. Airing in 1989, this is the third serial of the 26th season. And you can just tell from the beginning of the episode that this is a good doctor-companion relationship. This time, the setting is in Northumberland during World War II. At a nearby secret naval base, a scientist has created a computer to crack German codes. But instead of using it to crack German code, he thinks that he should use it to crack the code on a crypt in a nearby church, and that is going to release Fenric. After witnessing a couple local girls getting swallowed by fog while swimming, we learn that Fenric has been tricking people to get back at the doctor for previously trapping him. The kind of big revelation of this episode, the big, I don't know, kind of interesting plot point, I guess, is that the doctor sets up this game of chess to play against Fenric. And the kind of block in this game of chess is that Ace creates this psychic barrier. And he basically has to cruelly break the faith that she has in him in order for them to allow the Ancient One, the leader of the Hamivores, to defeat Fenric. This is a really complicated plot. I feel like trying to explain some of these episodes is very sci-fi-y.
The Seventh Doctor is kind of quirky, interesting, played by Sylvester McCoy, and I think I would put him somewhere at the high end of the middle for me.
I would agree. I thought he was good.
And I really have to say I enjoyed, and I know she's kind of a fan favorite, his companion at this point, Ace.
Yes.
Ace is Ace.
I agree. Ace is Ace. Yeah, she was very enjoyable. I thought there is this whole storyline, ends up that she's traveling back in time, and it turns out that it's her mom that she's experiencing, or this baby that she doesn't want to hold. She's like, "Oh, that's my mom's name." And she kind of has this weird relationship, a strange relationship with her mom. And she had a lot of layers to her character because of that, that were kind of, I felt like, opened and revealed through this episode. It felt very genuine and very, I don't know, kind of neat to see unfold.
Yeah, like she was very close with the baby's mom. She'd become friends with her.
And then it turned out to be your grandma.
Yeah. It was very interesting, but like cleverly done. And yeah, I enjoyed both of them.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
As a doctor and a companion.
I agree. I didn't realize before really diving into Doctor Who to make this video that 1989, when the show was canceled, that it didn't get rebooted until 2005, that there was this 16-year gap that was only filled in with a movie. The Eighth Doctor, portrayed by Paul McGann, is featured in the 1996 Doctor Who TV film, which was an attempt to reboot the show, which didn't actually happen because it didn't get rebooted for, 9 years? But this movie was really good. It was very intense. On one of the Doctor's travels, a weird box breaks open in the TARDIS and ooze comes out of it, which crawls into the TARDIS and messes it up. He ends up emergency landing in San Francisco and kind of in the middle of a gang fight. He ends up getting shot. The ooze is seeping out of the TARDIS into the streets of San Francisco. The Doctor is dying. These are dire times. Confused by his two hearts, he ends up being pronounced dead on the operating table. He's taken to the morgue, and it is here where he regenerates to the Eighth Doctor, which I thought this was a very interesting plot up until this point. I mean, it still continued to be too. The Bad Ooze, known as the Master, takes over the body of a paramedic, one very handsome Eric Roberts, might I add. He tries to steal the Doctor's remaining lives, which would also destroy the planet, because of course it would. The stakes are high, but with the help of the surgeon who, I guess, killed him on the operating table, the Doctor does not let that happen. I loved this movie. I thought it was very suspenseful. I thought that Paul McGann was a good doctor. It was an interesting story. And we got to see a lot of the TARDIS. And it turns out the TARDIS has a cloister room. And the cloister room looks like a Buffy set.
It does.
I'm a big fan of Buffy the Vampire Slayer, so I was like, yeah, cloister room for the win.
I mean, I thought it was a little silly, but I still liked it. I still enjoyed it. And I feel like, I know I've read online and stuff that movie kind of has a bad rap. Huh. And it's not perfect, but I still enjoyed it quite a bit.
I didn't know that. I really liked it. It's interesting because this movie was them attempting to reboot the series.
Yeah.
So obviously it didn't perform that well for them that they didn't reboot the series from the movie, but I thought it was such a good movie. I liked it a lot.
And they were trying to make it a thing in the US with that too, which is why they set it in San Francisco along with the BBC. It also played on Fox, which I don't remember that as a kid, but it played on Fox because they were attempting to get a US audience for Doctor Who.
I didn't know that. Apparently we didn't come along yet.
And hence the Eric Roberts being in it too, which is a very American person that I don't know that you would see Eric Roberts in a British film.
No, but he is like an 80s, 90s icon in the US, so it was good to see him. Also, if you aren't aware, Julia Roberts' brother.
And Emma Roberts' dad.
Oh, yes. So he's a well-known American actor. It was exciting to see him. The thing that I think was so enjoyable to me about this movie is that it felt like a movie.
Yeah.
But, you know, I think we've watched all these arcs where it's like four episodes. And in those four episodes, they have to be very pivotal and precise about the plot of it, because you have to end every episode with a cliffhanger to get people to come back next week. And so I felt without those restraints, it just had this really nice flow to it that was something I really enjoyed about it.
We have officially made it to the reboot, the place that most people told us to start with. The two-part episode, The Empty Child and The Doctor Dances, are the 9th and 10th episodes of the only season where Christopher Eccleston portrays the Doctor. The setting is London in 1941. The companion Rose gets separated from the Doctor while trying to help a boy she sees wearing a gas mask. She climbs a rope that ends up being connected to a balloon, and this is where we first meet Captain Jack, who rescues her. On his own journey, the Doctor discovers a hospital, where he learns that people have a sickness where they have a gas mask being attached to their face. I don't know, it's kind of weird, but it's also kind of disturbing. And possibly the most unsettling part is that they can communicate through phone lines. And when you do hear them, they simply say,
"Are you my mummy?"
It's kind of weird. It's kind of creepy. They figure out that a crash medical ship had nanogenes on board. And in an attempt to save a dying boy, the nanogenes thought a gas mask was part of his DNA. Hence making the gas mask people. The big reveal is that the boy has been following his sister around asking if she was his mummy when she indeed was his mummy.
The ending to this episode was kind of sweet for how unsettling the rest of the episodes were.
Yeah, that's true.
This being the first Doctor that I've seen before we made this video.
Yeah.
I would say that this is probably the most memorable story from Christopher Eccleston's run. I just remember this one was so memorable at the time, and I felt like "Are You My Mummy" was stuck in my head for weeks afterwards.
Yeah.
It's just a very iconic set of episodes.
I don't think of Eccleston as one of my favorite doctors, but watching it, it's like, no, he's really good.
I agree. I thought when we started the show, when Jeremy first got me into the show, I enjoyed Christopher Eccleston enough that I watched the whole season.
Yeah.
But then once we got to Tennant, it was like, oh, he's a great doctor. And so I think it is. It's like, oh, you know, being able to rewatch this, it really shows the talent that Christopher Eccleston had. Yeah. He was really funny. There's a few moments that are very funny.
Go now! Go grab the banana!
Why not?
Good source of potassium!
Also, I think one of the references to the episode is about dancing. The doctor dances. And it's a really funny scene where Rose is trying to get him to dance. And he says, Rose, he's like, no. And she's like, what? You know, show me your moves. If you can dance, show me your moves. And he says,
Rose, I'm trying to resonate concrete.
And it was just, yeah, a good one.
It's really good. Yeah. I mean, it introduces Rose, who is, I think, a lot of people's favorite companion from the reboot, and she's great, and John Barrowman's really entertaining as Captain Jack. It's a really good set of episodes, and also written by Stephen Moffat, who would later take over the show. For the 10th Doctor, the Screen Rant article picked the two-part serial Human Nature and the Family of Blood. While these definitely aren't David Tennant's most iconic episodes of the Doctor, they definitely are a showcase of his acting ability. The Doctor is hiding in human form to escape the Family of Blood, who need his Time Lord life essence so they do not die. It's 1913 England, and he is John Smith, a very unaware human. The Family of Blood tracks him to England, where they start taking bodies of the locals and creating pretty creepy living scarecrows. Martha, the Doctor's companion, has figured out that they've found him, and she's trying to help him. But he ends up falling in love with one of the local women. And despite how hard he tries to stay human and be John Smith, he eventually becomes the Doctor again, and then fights off those scarecrow animating creeps, the Family of Blood.
I thought that the last story that we watched was the creepiest one, until we saw the scarecrow people of this episode, and I went, no, this is, that's unsettling. I don't like it.
That's fair. I don't think I thought they were as creepy as you did.
I did not like them.
I didn't like them either, but I think that Are You My Mummy is maybe a little creepier. I mean, we kind of stated this before. This isn't like the most iconic David Tennant thing you're gonna see.
No. I think what's interesting is that he is this other human character for most of the episode.
Like 80% of it.
And you kind of start to not like him. Honestly.
I mean, you do kind of. I didn't really think about that, but you're right.
You're like, by the end, you're like, oh my God, shut up. Stop being such a coward. Just be the Doctor again. And he's so cowardly.
And what sort of man is that? And now you expect me to die.
He does not want to become the Doctor again. He wants to live out this life and have this love of his life. And Martha is the one that ends up convincing him that he needs to become the Doctor again. I love David Tennant's Doctor so much.
Yeah.
And I spent most of this episode being like, ugh, I hate him.
It's like you want him to be the Doctor again.
Mm-hmm.
And it is just kind of like a great exercise in seeing his acting skills.
It's true. Definitely and shows off his acting chops.
Yeah, why this list picked these episodes.
Mm-hmm. The one thing that I thought was so lovely and nice about this one being chosen for the one that we watch is that, you know, we have Rose, who's a very iconic companion.
Yeah.
And then Donna, who I love, is like, Doctor and Donna is like my favorite combination.
Catherine Tate's great.
Yeah, I just love Catherine Tate. His current companion, I think she kind of gets kind of a bad rap because she's in between some other iconic people, but this episode really showcased what a great companion she really is.
Yeah, I think even if she isn't my favorite of his companions, she is really good. And this also shows her chops off as well as being a really good companion as well.
Yes, and there's a scene where the woman that the Doctor is dating, that John Smith, his human form, is dating, and she's like, you're a doctor? You're a black woman doctor? No way. And she's like, oh, you don't believe me? And starts naming off the bones in her hand.
Carpal bones, proximal row, scaphoid, lunate, triquetral, pisiform, distal row, trapezium, trapezoid, capitate, hammock. Then the metacarpal bones extending in three distinct phalanges, proximal, middle, distal.
Yeah, I just felt like it was a very powerful moment where she was like, yeah, I am. She really does endure a lot of challenges in this episode.
Yeah.
And she really triumphs over all of them. She overcomes every obstacle because in the end, it's Martha. Martha is the reason he comes back.
Yeah.
So go Martha. I think maybe that's why I was a little disappointed, is because his performance is so good in this that it made me not really like that character.
Yeah.
I just wanted him to be the doctor again. But it was a good episode.
It was a good arc. Yeah.
I don't know. What's your favorite David Tennant episode? Or I guess in general, as we're going through this list, is there an episode that we missed so far that you think we should go back and rewatch? Is there a storyline that is worth watching of one of the other doctors?
Yes, you should let us know.
God Complex is in the sixth season or series of the reboot, and we are experiencing Matt Smith, the 11th Doctor. In this episode, he is accompanied by Amy Pond, his main companion, and Rory, her, I think, husband at this point, but I don't remember. He might just still be fiancé. They find themselves trapped in a hotel, and they cannot get out. The corridors of the hotel itself seems to change also. They find other people in the hotel, and they basically learn that every person at the hotel has a room that contains their greatest fear. And once they go into that room, they essentially get brainwashed and allow themselves to be taken. The doctor eventually realizes that people's faith is what is allowing them to be taken. And Amy has now been drawn into her room. She is experiencing that same willingness to be taken. And so the doctor, knowing that she has faith in him, has to strip her faith of him. The 11th Doctor getting Amy Pond to lose her faith in him is a emotional roller coaster. I think what really makes a good episode is a combination of great story, great dialogue, and just those like funny, quirky quips that the doctor has.
Big day for a fan of walls.
And I feel like this checks all the boxes.
Yeah.
Matt Smith is a very funny doctor. This concludes the end of the three doctors that I watched previously. We're getting into new territory for me, and I think for you too.
Yeah, I've watched a few Peter Capaldi episodes, but not the one that we watched for this. From one emotional episode to the next, for the 12th Doctor, played by Peter Capaldi, we watched the episode Heaven Sent. We learn that Clara, his companion, has died, and he's so angry and so fearful. He's in a castle running from a cloaked figure. When the cloaked figure almost catches up with him, he admits that he's afraid to die. Everything stops and the castle changes. Over this happening again, he deduces that he's in some sort of torture chamber. Every time he's confronted by the cloaked figure and admits a deep truth, the castle resets itself. During each reset, he finds bones and strange clues, like the word bird written in sand, and a clue telling him to find room 12. When he finally does make it to room 12, he finds a mineral that is harder than diamond, that he assumes is keeping him away from the TARDIS. He has a revelation that all the clues and bones that he found were left by himself, and that the teleport chamber that he started out in has a copy of him. So he burns himself to set up the next copy. Over thousands of years, he finally breaks through the mineral and finds out that he is on Gallifrey. He tells a young boy to tell the Time Lords that he knows what they did and that the hybrid proposed by them is in fact him.
This episode was such a poignant, beautiful episode. I felt like the last one that we watched with Matt Smith was so emotional and so raw, and this one was even more so. This is probably, of all of the episodes that I've seen, which is much more limited, the single best episode I've ever seen of Doctor Who.
It was very interesting. It was very strong. It is like a single character piece, basically.
What makes this episode so different and so unique is that it's all Peter Capaldi.
Yeah.
He's the only person in this episode. You hear his internal dialogue, the things that he's saying out loud, and that's it. That's all you get in this episode, and he carries it so well.
Yeah.
Come on, chop, chop! The doctor will see you now. Show me what you've got.
The only other thing in this is a hooded creature that doesn't speak.
Yeah.
So it is all basically his internal dialogue
mm-hmm.
and talking to himself. And it is just so strong and emotional. And like I had said, I'd watched some other Peter Capaldi episodes before, And I liked them, but I wasn't expecting to be, like, bowled over as much as I was with this episode.
Clara, who was a Matt Smith companion.
Yeah.
I haven't seen any of her episodes even with Matt Smith. She's now carried over to Capaldi and has now died. This episode is him grieving. It's him grieving her death. And...
like, feeling responsible for it. On a certain level.
It is just so much about death and grief, and just like he's stuck in this loop, and that's like what grief is. And so it hits home, it's hard. Can I get through this? At one point he says something that like choked me up so much. Like I cried like multiple times throughout this episode. I feel like I'm crying now just talking about it. It's such a raw emotional episode dealing with grief that it's like even tough to talk about. At one point he says something like,
"The day you lose someone isn't the worst. At least you've got something to do. It's all the days they stay dead."
So anyway, it's a really good episode. I would highly recommend watching it, but like, you know, bring a box of tissue with you.
And I think it's pretty standalone other than Clara. You don't need to necessarily know what's going on.
Yeah, you could just watch this
episode
and have no context and know nothing about the show. And it would be a truly riveting thing to watch.
Yeah, I think so.
No matter what you know about Doctor Who, it's just a very...
it's
very good,
very
episode.
Well written and acted, and it's very good.
Let's move into something a little less depressing, but good on you, Peter Capaldi, because you brought your A game to that one.
Yeah. The Haunting of the Villa of Diodati is the 8th episode of the 12th series. The 13th Doctor is portrayed by Jodie Whittaker. The Doctor takes her 3 companions to Lake Geneva in 1816 to witness Mary Shelley's inspiration for Frankenstein. At the villa, they find Mary, her infant, and a few other people, but Mary's fiancé Percy is missing. Strange events are occurring, and the Doctor suspects these occurrences are actually part of a security system designed to hide something. An apparition reveals itself, and it turns out that it is a half-converted Cyberman looking for the element Siberian, a liquid metal containing the collective knowledge of the Cybermen. The Doctor discovers that Percy, who is hiding in the cellar, is possessed by the Siberian. The Doctor tricks the Siberian into leaving Percy's body and entering hers, but the half-converted Cyberman threatens to destroy the planet, forcing the Doctor to give him the Siberian.
Well, the first thing I noticed about the 13th Doctor
is
that Bradley Walsh was one of her companions.
That is true.
I was like, hey, the guy from The Chase!
Yeah.
And also, blankety-blank.
Blankety-blank, yeah.
That was very exciting. Didn't know that he was a Doctor Who companion.
Nope, did not.
But that
know.
Was very exciting. We were like, yeah, we love British game shows. So we were excited to see a British...
one of our favorites.
A game show host being represented. We do love The Chase.
Yeah.
That's all I have. I was just excited about him. That's not true. As you witnessed from my meltdown a minute ago, the Peter Capaldi episode was a really tough episode to follow because it was just so well done. And I thought that this episode was a little underwhelming overall, but I thought that that was more the story and the premise.
Yeah.
And not necessarily a reflection of any of the acting or characters.
No, I think the acting was good. And I think the story wasn't even bad. I think it was just a little more silly after this. We watched this pretty intense Capaldi episode that this is kind of like a haunted house episode, which isn't a bad thing.
It was a fun episode.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I thought that Jodie Whittaker was a really funny doctor. She kind of reminded me a little bit of Matt Smith, but like kind of her own version.
Yeah, and I think that is one of the things I like with so many people portraying the Doctor is they can add some quirks from the people before them, but also have their own thing going on.
Mm-hmm.
I liked how obsessed with hats and the helmets she was. It was very, like you said, Matt Smith, kind of reminded me of the Fez thing. I have seen one other episode of hers, which was the very first one, and I enjoyed her in both the episodes, so I look forward to at some point getting to that point where we can watch more of her episodes.
At some point we're gonna catch up.
We will catch up, really.
I would like to see more of her episodes too. I thought she was a fun doctor.
Yeah.
I guess David Tennant being the 10th Doctor and then having a regeneration kind of before the most recent Doctor makes him the 14th Doctor as well.
So he's 10 and 14.
We didn't specifically watch his storyline for this, although...
We have watched
it. We did watch it, because I was like, oh, the Doctor and Donna's back together? You know I'm going to be there.
And they were all really fun.
And that brings us to the 15th Doctor. Since the Screen Rant article was published in 2023, we decided to use IMDb to choose the 15th Doctor episode. And at the time of filming, the top-rated episode on IMDb was The Legend of Ruby Sunday. The 15th Doctor, played by Ncuti Gatwa, and his companion Ruby, traveled to the unit headquarters. There has been this woman who has kept reappearing through the show as different people and, I guess, different objects. The Doctor learns from UNIT that Susan Triad, the face of S-Triad technology, who appears to be this same woman, is making a big announcement about her tech company, and she just might be up to no good. We don't know yet. They begin to speculate that this could be Susan, the Doctor's granddaughter. Hey, something we know! I feel like watching one episode of every story has made me filled in on the current timeline. They also think that this woman may be Ruby's biological mother who abandoned her as a baby. The Doctor has traveled to this exact point in time previously, so he can't travel there again, it'll mess up time. So they end up using this tape of security footage that Ruby had of the time that her biological mother left her at the church to use a time window so that they can recreate the scene from the tape. And this is a really eerie part of the story. It gets weird. During this experience, the TARDIS ends up becoming enveloped in smoke, and the security person from the unit team who went in to kind of keep watch on everything ends up disappearing, and they find him like burned later. As if he had been dead for hundreds of years, I think they say. They are no closer to getting any answers, and so the Doctor ends up going with Mel, who is the companion for the 6th and 7th Doctors. She makes a reappearance in the show. She helps him connect with Susan Triad. She does not appear to be Susan, the Doctor's granddaughter, but she does appear to be Sutek, a very classic Doctor Who villain, allegedly. We didn't see any of those episodes, but he seems very scary, and it also appears that he has somehow seduced the TARDIS and possibly has seduced it many episodes ago. Spooky. I thought that this was a really good episode. This new, I guess, second reboot now that we're in has had a lot of mixed reviews. Like, I think there's been a lot of kind of mixed emotions about the writing this season and kind of the story arc of this season, but I felt like this was a very strong episode.
No, I thought it was really interesting. I really like his Doctor so far.
I agree. So Sutek and this kind of like possession of the TARDIS, it appears has gone back as far as like maybe even David Tennant coming back, like the Doctor and Donna is maybe where it somehow came on there. And I saw online that the new intro, that you can see like weird stuff on the TARDIS in the new intro, which I didn't notice.
No, I didn't notice that.
But apparently it's been like that all season, and that's kind of alluding to that. I just think there's like kind of some Easter eggs happening here.
Well, and they made reference to the very first Doctor, which is something I don't feel like I've seen in other things that we talked about it earlier, that Susan is potentially the Doctor's, original Doctor's granddaughter.
Yeah, and I don't think it's clear. It seems like that's not the case, that she is in fact Sutek.
Yeah.
But it's kind of interesting that there's all these references to, you know, the first Doctor having a granddaughter, and then, you know, Mel being the companion of, I think, the 6th and 7th Doctors. Yeah. It's just interesting that there's all these ties and connections, and then the villain is a, you know, classic Doctor Who villain.
Yeah, it's like I think a fourth Doctor villain.
And apparently a pretty tough one to beat.
And I guess we didn't really mention Ruby. I like her as a companion.
Yes. Ruby seems, I don't know, just lovely. She seems like a fun companion.
She's a fun companion.
And Ncuti Gatwa, I think, plays a really good Doctor. I think he's really fun.
Can do a dramatic scene, but also embraces more of like the fun silliness that I kind of enjoy having that dichotomy.
I also think it's interesting because he has a cool outfit on in this episode, but I guess he's kind of had multiple outfit changes throughout the season, which I think is a very interesting different spin. And I'm like, all right, I'm interested to see where this goes.
Yeah.
I'm very much looking forward to where this is going. I think there have been a lot of mixed feelings about the season, but I think it's probably ending on a strong note.
Yeah.
So we'll see. I'm excited to see what the future holds for this Doctor.
I agree.
Of the span of this entire series. Well, what do you call a series? In the US, we call a series a season. And a series means like the entire show. So I always get confused, but what do you call a series? Just the run of the show?
I guess.
I don't know. What do you call an entire series that's the whole show if a series is a season? I don't know. I'm confusing myself.
You're confusing yourself.
Anyways, in the entire run of the show, any standout moments, standout doctors, anything like that?
I definitely want to go back to Tom Baker, mm-hmm. just because I think we both really enjoyed him and understand why he's a fan favorite now of the classic doctors. Colin Baker, I was surprised with how much fun Colin Baker was because I thought that outfit was real ridiculous. And that Capaldi episode made me want to jump back into Capaldi because mm-hmm. that's kind of where I fell off, mostly because you weren't caught up and it was running at the same time as we first got together. But that powerhouse of an episode makes me want to go back and finish those for sure.
I think I'd love to maybe at some point watch the entire series start to finish, but we've had people that have watched it that have told us that it took them, you know, years to do. So
yeah.
You'll have to let us know, what are your favorite episodes, your favorite doctor, any specific moments or episodes that we should go back to? Let us know. And if you have any suggestions, we've asked this in a previous video, but if you have any suggestions for British television shows, other shows that we should watch. Like, I think we got people telling us the In-Betweeners.
Yeah, In-Betweeners.
The Detectorists, I think. I don't know, I'd have to look it up. We've got some kind of like unique ones that I've never heard of. So definitely let us know what your suggestions are for shows we should watch in the future, because we'd love to explore more of the British television. Yeah.
Thank you to our patrons for coming along and supporting our adventures. We really appreciate you guys.
If you are a fan of other British things, like maybe British films. For example, Hot Fuzz, the Edgar Wright classic. You should watch our video where we went to Wells for the very first time and experienced the Hot Fuzz locations in person, including having our very first Cornetto ice cream ever from the shop that they go to in that movie. So yeah. You should go check it out. It'll be right here. We'll see you over there in that video.